Thanks for joining us for another For Investors by Investors Long Beach podcast. As always, we're proud to be your all education real estate resource without any kind of sales pitch. If you'd like to attend one of our meetings in person, we meet on the last Thursday of the month at the Grand in Long Beach, California. You can RSVP on forinvestorsbyinvestors.com/Long Beach. To find more investment resources such as blogs and podcasts and content from other FIBI groups, you can go to forinvestorsbyinvestors.com and search our entire library. Now, onto the podcast.
That being said, let's get started. Come on up, Mike. Mike is one of the largest developers that I know personally. So I don't know very many developers, but I know he knows his stuff. Mike has been working with FIBI Orange County for a really long time, and he's extremely experienced investor, done a ton of different stuff in the past and different asset classes, and really, really knows his stuff. Helped me a lot on just some advice on when I'm adding square footage to a house I just bought. So thanks, man. Come on up.
Yeah.
And give some great value, man.
You told me you're going to have some good questions today.
Yeah, I'll take care of it. Don't worry. You know? I told him there's a reason why I wanted him up here, so I could pick his brain for my own project. So
smart,
self-serving. So
glad to see a good crowd out here. This is kind of a niche topic, so it's something obviously near and dear to my heart. And you know, Matt asked me to talk about it. All right. And you know, the goal today is going to be to teach you the basics, the ins and outs, who, what, where, when, why, how to do it. So if you come across a piece of property, you don't ignore it, you don't run away from it, you're not intimidated by it, you A, either do something with it yourself, or B, you call me and we do something together with it. So that's the goal today. So Development 101. A little bit of background, I live in Signal Hill, right down the street, so it took me a whole 4 minutes to get over here. My wife, Lena, and our little son, Luke, just turned one. He's 4 months younger than Matt's son, so Matt is my parental advice. One of them, along with Google. So I went to UC San Diego and had apps. I started out bioengineering, and then I started taking physics, and I said, no, forget it. I have absolutely no interest in doing this, and I ended up poli-sci, but I ended up taking some urban studies classes, which is basically planning and zoning and how to create cities and redevelop them. And I had an interest in that. So after graduating, I needed to get a job. I started calling all the city governments in San Diego County, and finally ended up getting a job at the city of Del Mar. If you've ever been to Del Mar, it's a beautiful town. The job paid horribly, $8 an hour, but it did have some benefits. A, I got to surf every day on my lunch break, and B, I learned a lot about development, which has definitely paid off now that I'm doing that for a living. After that job, I ended up moving up to LA. I got a job with a local consulting firm. We did work with city governments, county governments, redevelopment work, economic development, helping the cities basically turn their older parts of the town into newer, redeveloped, better, higher tax rate paying properties. Finally, switched from that job over to the city of Long Beach. I worked in the affordable housing division there. We had a first-time homebuyer program, so I would sit and listen to these meetings where we would talk about the advantages of home buying. I finally figured, you know what, can't beat them, join them. I can buy a house. I ended up getting a fourplex. I could live in one unit, rent the other units out, live for free. I said, this is real estate stuff. This is the way to go. And from that point on, I was hooked. While at the city, I would sit in all these meetings with these developers who I knew were making a lot more money than me. But I knew they weren't any smarter than me. So I finally got to the point where it's like, again, you can't beat them, join them. I'm gonna join the other side of the fence. I'm gonna go out on my own. So much to the dismay of my parents, quit my job and went on my own, and I've been doing it ever since. So started out fixing and flipping houses, actually condos in downtown Long Beach. Back in the 90s, you could buy them for $40,000, fix them up $10,000 and flip them for $65,000. And I thought, wow, this is the best thing ever. So fortunately, couple of them I couldn't sell, kept them as long-term rentals, and ended up selling them down the road for $300,000, $400,000. So sometimes buy and hold is definitely the way to go. So 99, I came across some land that is actually owned by the city that they didn't even know they owned, put a bid in it, partnered with a guy who was an architect and a contractor who I met when I was at the city. We built five houses right over against the riverbed off of and from that point on, I was hooked at hooked on developing and building houses. So I've done almost 100 houses, also doing fixing and flipping. Today, I'm investing heavily in notes. I've done a couple with Gerald. Some of those notes have been foreclosed on. They've turned into rentals. Again, still doing the fixing and flipping. A lot of stuff outside of California now, finding better opportunities, including one. I just tied up a six-house subdivision in Apex, North Carolina, just in the past couple of weeks. So I just flew out there. I was out there last week checking it out. And I'll tell you a little bit about the comparison between North Carolina and California. You can imagine there's definitely some differences. So a licensed contractor since 1999, big proponent of green building. It's finally becoming more and more common. A lot of the cities are asking for a lot more energy efficiency. They want to get a list of the products you're using, you know, are they environmentally safe, sustainable, etc. So that's, it's becoming more and more popular. The building, we're getting better and better, greener and greener. So I'm happy to see that. The future, I don't know if anybody's seen the 3D printing of the house in China, but plus, as you know, real estate is basically, we're building the same way we've been doing it for decades. So it's a, it's an industry that's super ripe for disruption, and 3D printing, the prediction is, you know, 10 years, that's going to be how houses, apartments, and everything is built. So,
I wonder what that's going to do to the market if all of a sudden you build a house for $5-10 grand for 3D printing the thing or something. It'd be amazing.
It's going to have a dramatic effect. There's no doubt about it. And technology, you'll be able to live
in there first.
Yeah, so, well, you just have to be flexible
right.
in everything. So. So what is development? To me, it's basically taking a piece of property and improving on it, making it more valuable, making it better than it was before. So the different types, obviously you have residential, office, retail, and industrial, and there's different types of development. Redevelopment is what I did when I worked at the consulting firm. An example of a redevelopment project would be in Huntington Beach, the Grand Hyatt Hotel. I don't know if anybody from Huntington Beach? Okay, so I don't know if you guys remember, but that used to be a golf course and the Driftwood Mobile Home Park. But it was owned by the city. That was part of my job, was to negotiate a buyout of all those mobile homes and then negotiate with the developer to come in on that land, which is still owned by the city. It's a lease, but that is a perfect case of redevelopment, taking a piece of land that's being underutilized and maximizing the use on it. You missed Driftwood?
Yeah, awesome.
It was kind of nice, fishing flat right on, you know, right on the ocean. So, but the new hotel's pretty nice.
It's right.
Yeah, definitely. So repositioning property is another way to develop. That is basically what Matt's doing, is taking like a Class C apartment that's in a decent neighborhood and renovating it, raising the rents, and basically turning it into a Class B, where you're getting a better return and your property is obviously worth more money. Land development is taking a raw piece of land, getting it entitled, which basically means getting it approved to develop any structure on, and then putting in maybe the roads, the sewer, the water, all the infrastructure. Some companies do that specifically. They get it to the point where it's basically ready to build, and then they sell off to one of the big builders to generally a pretty good profit. So development is the ultimate way to force appreciation on a property. You take a piece of land, you build a house on it, it's obviously going to be worth a lot more money. So you found your first deal. I mean, inevitably, if you're in real estate long enough, you're going to come across a property that's a teardown. You're going to come across a vacant lot. So what do you do with it when you find it? And this, the picture over on the right here, this is a, that's a house being torn down. I don't know if you've ever seen a house demoed, but 6 to 9 months to build a house, they come down in the morning. Everything is gone. By the afternoon, it's scraped, everything is gone. It's, I mean, in a way, it's sad, but it happens that quickly. So you find a piece of property, obviously the first thing, you gotta go take a look. You gotta go drive by, you know, the picture's not gonna tell you anything. You don't know how the surrounding area is. You know, is there a liquor store on one side, you know, porn shop on the other, school across the street, a power plant behind it. So you gotta get out. I mean, that's true of any kind of real estate property. Get out, and you gotta get out of the car. You can't just drive by. You gotta get out, and you know, I suggest you walk whole property. You got to find out, you know, does it slope downward? Is there, you know, is there a sewer manhole in the middle? Is there, you know, did somebody bury some old cars? You want to know what's going on with the property. So definitely the first thing.
What are some of the things you have to do when you're dealing with like the ground and soil and things like that? You're kind of testing that. What are the landmarks you have to look out for?
Well, definitely whether it's native soil, you know, it has to be soil, you have to be able to compact it. So a lot of times it'll be like fill, you know, maybe they dumped soil on top of the, you know, the original land. So that's going to be, I'll get into that a little bit, but that's definitely an issue in a lot of areas, and you got to test the land, and that'll dictate what kind of foundation you have on the property. So that's, I'll get into that a little bit. So after you go look at the property, what's the next step? You got to go over to City Hall, go stop at the planning department. The zoning, you want to know the zoning. R1, you build one house on. R2, two houses. R3, R4, that's multifamily. It's going to dictate how many units you can build based on how much square footage on the lot. So you might be able to, you know, if you have a 6,000 square foot lot, R3, R4, you might be able to put an 8-unit building on. So obviously that's going to affect the value of the property. Floor area ratio, that is common for residential. It's going to dictate how big a property you can build, how big a house you can build. So you got a 5,000 square foot lot, you got a 40% floor area ratio, that means you can build a 2,000 square foot house. So that's the basic, and that's going to vary by city. They're all they're similar, but every city has their own set of guidelines. And that's basically the zoning guidelines are going to dictate what you can build. Go ahead.
A second story JTAC?
No. No, so it's the total floor area of the property. So height restrictions, that's going to dictate, you know, can you have 8-foot ceilings, 9-foot ceilings, 10-foot ceilings? Can you go 2 stories? You know, can you, how much can you pitch the roof? So that's obviously a restriction, especially if it's an area that has view issues. Setbacks, how close to the front yard, how close to the street can you be? That can dictate, obviously, again, how big a house can you build. The rear yard setback, how close can you be to the rear property line? Side yard setbacks as well. This is a house that we did in Redondo Beach on a small lot. This is a 3,200 square foot lot. So not a lot of room there. And you can't really tell from the photo, but the street is at an angle and we had a 20 foot setback. So like this part right here, this part of the garage, this is one of one part of the garage sticks out a little further. This one is back a little bit. This area is back a little bit. So we had to kind of mimic the slope of the street in order to maintain that 20-foot setback all the way along. So the city didn't think we could plan and build on this lot. But we gave them a design that they couldn't turn down, even though they took forever to approve. That's California for you. So,
say it's a single-family home over my next R4. Do you have to like ask the neighbors or like put up, you know, stakes in the post?
Typically, it's just going to be for view. So, yeah. So, Signal Hill has a view ordinance. So, part of, you know, and it's kind of vague on how it's written. You're just supposed to do things to mitigate the obstruction of someone's view. But part of that whole process, I don't know if you've seen it, where they have basically the outline of the property, what it's going to look like, with the impact. You got to go to the neighbor's house and take photos of it. You know, even though you do a lot to mitigate it, they still go to the city council meeting and tell, well, little planning in the city council, how you're gonna ruin their life. So long story. I had one quick story. I was building some houses in Signal Hill and went to the planning commission meeting, and we were building a house in front of a four-unit condo complex, and 80 people showed up against the project, and it was just myself and my architect, and we looked around and said, oh man, this is horrible. And they got up in the middle of the meeting and unraveled a giant photo showing their existing view and how we were going to ruin the view and so forth. And fortunately, I had done enough to mitigate the view issues, and I got the project approved. Mm-hmm. That was 80-1 or 80-2 was not numbers in our favor. Go ahead.
So can you find a lot of this information online, or do you have to go to the city planning department?
Yeah, a lot of it's online. Okay. Yeah, absolutely. The one thing that is hard to find online is the zoning. Okay. What exactly the zoning is. So, you know, like the assessor role will have it, but a lot of times that's outdated. So going to the city, you'll confirm exactly what the zoning is.
Where's the best way to find it online?
It's going to be in the city ordinance. Usually they'll all have, basically it's the zoning guidelines will dictate what you can build on what particular zone. But again, you need to know for sure what the zoning is of your property. So that's why I say go down to City Hall. So we just talked about view ordinances, architectural standards. Some cities have additional standards they want to see. Yeah, they want to see, like on this property right here, that second story had to be set back an extra 10 feet from the first story. They may want to see, like we had to put these, we had to put the shutters on the side. So different cities will have different ordinances or different guidelines they want. If it's in a historic area, they might have a historic overlay zone. They might want some older style features on the house. So again, that's something you're going to find from going down to City Hall. Public Works, you want to find out, is there city sewer? Is there city water? Are there the utilities going to be there? Because if they're not, it's going to be a big issue. There's a couple of houses that were built in Signal Hill right on Hill Street where the guy built them without any of the utilities. So he built the houses, got all the way to the finish. Couldn't get them approved because he didn't have any utilities to them. Those houses sat vacant for about 15 years, and they finally got torn down. So, yeah, some people lost a lot of money on that. Go ahead.
What about CC&R is also sometimes they'll restrict like what kind of roof it might be or siding.
Yeah, that's a good point. That would be like those architectural guidelines. So if you're in an area that has its own HOA, that they may have their own review board that looks at the design as well as obviously their own restrictions, even to the point of what color, what kind of roof, you know, et cetera.
I just ran into that. They had to approve the patio door. Yeah, it had to be a certain patio door.
Did they approve it? Okay, good. Sometimes they don't, so sometimes that can be a messy fight. So how do you know how much to pay for the property? So you get this question a lot. And basically with land, you kind of back into the land value. So you're gonna take the expected sales price. So what you can sell the property for, you're gonna deduct your sales costs, your expenses, escrow, title, realtors. You're going to deduct the cost to build it, and you're going to deduct what you want to make as a profit. And that is going to equal what you want to pay for the land. So this example, you got a house, you can sell it for $600,000. You're going to spend $30,000 in sales costs. It's going to cost you $300,000 to build. You want to make $120,000, so 20%. Can pay $150,000 for the lot. So obviously the value, you know how to find that. If you know how to comp properties, you find a good realtor, and they'll help you determine how much you can sell for the property. Used to be for new homes, you would get a 20% premium. This is pre-2008. You would get a 20% premium per square foot. Now it's closer to maybe 10%. So not quite as much as it used to be. Go ahead.
A big range there for the permanent developer fees and the architect and engineer fees, 545. So what are some of the considerations that go into some of those numbers and why a big
The cost?
Yeah, like the architect.
Yeah.
Cost.
Okay.
45 is a big difference.
Right? Sure. So, California, expensive state to build. Permit fees, $20,000 to $30,000. It depends on the size of the house, but almost all cities have, you not only have the builder permit fees, but you have development impact fees. So they want developers to pay for a future park or future, you know, infrastructure projects. So they all have a bunch of fees on their lease. Inland Empire, no matter what size house you build, you're probably going to be spending $30,000 on your building permit and development fees. So it can range. Other states. Oh, yeah, go ahead. Yeah, I'll make these available if anybody wants them. I'll have my info.
Well,
there you go. Even better. Less work for me. So, you know, I said I'm doing a project in North Carolina, $10,000 per house out there, so obviously a lot less. The architect, engineer, the $5,000 is probably if you're using a draftsman, so not a licensed architect. If it's a house, it's kind of a standard floor plan. Maybe you're just modifying an existing floor plan. You can use a draftsman. As long as you get an engineer to design all the detailed drawings and all the construction drawings and stamp it, you're fine with that. They're not going to have quite the same skill set. So if you're doing a high-end home, you're probably going to want to use a high-end architect. And we've done a lot of projects in Pacific Palisades. And there, it's kind of like the name of the architect is almost one of the first things on the listing. So if people want, you know, somebody who they know who's designed the house, it's, you know, prestigious. So it can make a difference. Plus they know that market, they know what the buyers want and what they expect. So that's kind of the range. Typically on a house in Long Beach, we might pay $15,000 for the plans. High-end home, typically about $30,000.
Right?
Yeah. This is all new construction, new build. So some of that is for the architect and some of it is for the engineer to do all of their all of the detailed drawings. Loan costs, obviously a bank is going to be cheaper, very difficult. It used to be very easy. You know, you had subprime lending for houses, we had subprime lending for construction. Super easy to get a loan back in 2004, 2005. Very, very difficult now. But if you can do it, you're going to pay less. You're going to pay 1 point. You're going to pay maybe 6% interest, and that can make, you know, a big difference on the project. Private lending is similar to hard money. You might pay a little bit extra because there's more construction draws. It's a longer period, but typically 2 to 3 points and 9 to 10% interest is kind of what we're seeing, which is a good incentive to get in, get out, and get the thing built. So you, hard money lender doesn't make more money than you. Go ahead.
Let's say I buy a property using a regular mortgage. And can I tear up the house and still build on it without notifying the bank?
Yes, you can do that. But they're not going to be happy when they do find out. If they find out.
In 5 months and they don't find out.
Well, first of all, you'd have to come in with the money to build the new house on it. But they're, you know, I guarantee in the loan docs there's something that talks about, you know, doing anything to decrease the value of the property. So, I mean, you're running a risk that they would foreclose on. But yeah, you can do it. I've never done it. No. Too risky. So construction costs, there's a big range there. This is going to depend on, you know, where you're building and the quality you're building. So 125 would be like a $450,000 house in Long Beach. That's about as cheap as you're gonna get it. That might be the same for if you're adding on your house. I think 125 is a pretty fair. It's gone up. Last year probably been about 110, but construction's picking up. Subs are getting busier. They're starting to charge a little bit more. So costs have gone up a little bit, even from a year ago. High end, $300 a foot. We did a lot of multi-million dollar homes in Pacific Palisades. About $250 a foot is what we're our cost to build up there. So definitely a range. But the advantage up there, you're selling for $1,000 a foot. So it's worthwhile.
Normal renovation, you know, adding square footage type stuff, not full build, but you know, 100 to like you said, 300 depending on the pricing. But just from it's amazing the difference. You know, but at the same time, you don't know what kind of quality you're getting. It's really hard to determine. You see some contractors coming in on a, you you know, on a building 100 square, you're going, you know, what is that including? And, you know, are they getting you in some other way? Versus, you know, sometimes it's hard to gauge what you should be paying, you know, and to include for the kind of materials you want. For a mid-sized house, like a normal home, you know, normal construction home on a new build versus an add-on, what are the ranges you see on like an add-on versus in a brand new build? Because a new build can cost a lot more, I would assume, right? Apparently.
Not necessarily, not on a square foot basis. I mean, generally on a remodel, though, you're going to remodel the rest of the house, so that's going to add to your overall cost. But generally on a per square foot basis, it's going to be about the same. This is a tiny, you're just doing a tiny addition. You know, if you're just adding a bathroom, you're going to pay more per square foot because there's more going on.
I got the plumbing. Like 100 a square, then I got close at 150, and then another one at 200. And so, you know, it's hard to tell, like, okay, is the 200 guy really all-inclusive with the other ones or not for some reason? I'll assume the 100 one is not. They're skipping some stuff.
Yeah, that's, you know, to me, that's definitely below market. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, and then that's what is a little scary, right? Because a lot of people, they may want to go based on cost per square foot when they're choosing a contractor, but that may not be the best way to go all the time when, you know, one contractor, it's not apples to apples, right? You have somebody that goes through and doesn't include, you know, every piece of material or tries to lowball the material cost when they know you're probably going to pick out materials a little bit higher versus the higher cost contractor on a square footage basis, maybe picking some materials that they know you're probably going to want versus, you know, the real cheap stuff like the 100 square foot guy uses, you know. And so that's, I think a lot of people have issues, I know I did, obviously, with not being sure which one to go with because you don't know if you're comparing apples to apples unless you do the full analysis yourself on all your materials. You know?
Well, that's a big part of it is, you know, that's obviously how you end up with a lot of disputes with your contractor. So, you know, the more that's spelled out ahead of time, the better. And, you know, if you have a scope of work, then you have a set of plans and a scope of work, they can bid on those, and then you're getting apples to apples.
And when you're new, so someone who's new with construction doesn't understand every piece of material that goes into the house, from light switches to, you know, recessed lighting to every little, you know, nook and cranny, the knobs on the cabinets and things like that. How would you recommend them to know that they have a bid that's all inclusive? You know, in that kind of case, is there an easy way to kind of determine, you know, if there's things missing that, you know, someone who may not understand or know?
Yeah, definitely. The more detailed the plans are, the better. So if you have a set of plans, if you have an architect, you're going to pay a little extra. They put in a plumbing plan, they put on the electrical plan where they show all the outlets, they show the switches, they show, you know, how many recessed lighting, you know, units, cans you're going to have, how many ceiling fans and so forth. And so then you're having the contractor bid on that more detailed set of plans. Also, they can call out the type of windows you want, the type of doors. And so the more detail you have on the plans, the more likely you are to get what you want. So you have a contract that says, we want what's on these set of plans. And you have them detail out, you know, we're putting in 36 can lights and, you know, 50 decor switches. So there's definitely some homework you need to do on your end. But again, the more detail you have in the plans and the scope of work, the better off you're going to be.
That's also, I mean, the wood is wood, right? So they're going to build it for this California code.
Correct.
But then your difference, I mean, your finishes, that's where the price is going to be the difference. You know, the type of paint, your carpet, the finishes that you have, that's where it's going to be the difference. So electrical is electrical. Plumbing is going to be the copper, you specify copper versus the new PVC or the new stuff that they have now, right?
Yeah.
Coming in,
right? Yes. Yeah.
So that's what is going to be the difference. But as far as the structure itself or the structural, it should be the same. There's no, because that's the stuff that the inspectors are going to change.
Right.
The other stuff is, you know, the miscellaneous stuff like your faucet, your you know, tub, your sinks, that's where the price is going to be the range.
Right. That's where you got to have it detailed out. Right. You can't just say, I'm going to paint it. What color are you going to paint it? What, you know, eggshell, flat.
Right.
So. Definitely, I'll talk a little bit more about it, but definitely the more detail, the better. Go ahead.
Are you thinking 125
That's my cost. Yeah. So 170, I mean, it depends on what you're doing. What are you building?
If we do a guest house, it's 2 bedrooms, 2 baths, guest house, 650 square feet.
So you're gonna, because you have 2 baths in there, you're gonna pay a little bit higher per square foot. Like if you had another bedroom, you know, the bedroom is just the bedroom. There's no plumbing, there's just a little bit of electrical. So your overall cost per square foot would go down. But that's not too far off. But, you know, 125 would be very basic, very plain stucco box house. It's not bad. A lot of it is what kind of finishes, you know, what quality of plumbing fixtures and
what's that PB homes with that? They're doing like a huge subdivision, and they're basing around $60 a foot.
Yeah, 60-65. Yeah, standard. And we're building in North Carolina $75 a foot. So again, it's different. It's much different there. You don't have earthquakes, so it's a much different standard house. The framing is different, the foundation is different, and the overall engineering of the house is much different. So much cheaper though. So contingency, always there's going to be issues. I mean, anybody who's done construction, Gerald, you've done a lot of construction, you know, there's going to be something that you didn't think of that you're going to want later on in the house. And basically, you know, you've got a set of plans. It's two-dimensional. You got laid out on a piece of paper, but you're building something in real life, outdoors, that's never been built before. It's a, you know, first time. So inevitably there's going to be issues that come up. So you've always got to build in a contingency to cover that, so you're not short at the end of the project. And you know, we've had some almost come in right on budget and almost come in right on time, but none that have actually ever come in under budget.
I was going to say, just stay with the 5%, I don't think that you want to get 10%.
For residential, I think it's a pretty good. You know, if you're doing a lot of roads and sewers, you know, then there's more chance for something to get missed. But for residential construction, 5% is pretty good. And then developer profit, I always shoot for 20%. 15 would be the lowest, 30% is the best I've ever done. So obviously doing development, you're taking on more risk than doing a fix and flip, so you need a better reward to do it.
Is that cash on cash or?
That would be based on the sales price. So if you're selling the house for $1 million, you want to make $200,000. So typically, new construction, you're going to have a longer escrow period. You're going to want more time for due diligence to talk to the city, get the land, like Matt was saying, get the soils tested. There's definitely a lot more to it. If it's a bigger project, you know, sometimes we even have a 90-day escrow. There might be 30 days due diligence and then another 30 days extension. You know, it really depends on the, you know, how complicated the project is. What we like to do is actually start, if it's a project we really like, we like to start the design, start the floor plan, start the exterior elevation, so by the time we're ready to close, we've already got a head start on it. And we'll even, you know, even go into the city, have them take a look at it, again, just to speed up the process, because, go ahead.
Do you use, to create the plans for every property, or have you reused plans?
They haven't been identical, but very similar. We've done a lot, you know, once you find something that works in an area,
right,
it makes sense to keep using it. So, you know,
so
what
to tweak the plans, it's not going to definitely have to cost you more, just creating new plans.
No, definitely a lot less expensive. A lot less expensive.
That kind of plan.
We're gonna get to that.
Did you say you did you do your soil checking during escrow? And is that for like if the lot is on a hill, or if it's just a cookie cutter flat lot? Do you guys do soil checking?
If it was a hillside lot, yes. If it's a hillside lot, yeah.
No. What if it's just a regular?
No.
Okay.
So we'll wait. We'll wait till later on. Yeah. We'll wait till we actually own it. It makes more sense.
On an actual rehab job, do you ever feel the plans are finished with the city? Can you go through and start demoing and all that stuff beforehand, or is it better to not do anything at all until the permits are all finished and everything?
No, we'll demo the house. Okay. We'll demo the house. Sometimes you demo the house and then it just sits there vacant. Yeah. And then you wish, well, maybe I shouldn't have demoed the house. Yeah. You're anxious to get going. You want to get started. So you want to do something.
So,
what's that?
Rents waters.
Yeah, that's true. No liability. So again, I'm saying, yeah, we like to get in and at least get the process started with the city. One critical thing in development is you really got to check the title report carefully and make sure there's no easements on the property that's going to prevent you from building a part of it, because obviously that's going to affect what you can build and the value of the project. So the construction drawing, so once you've got the floor plan design, you've got the architect, he's designed all the exterior elevations of the property, then the next step is it goes to the engineer, and he actually designs all of the detailed drawings on the blueprints. So how is the foundation designed? How is the foundation connecting to the framing? And how is the roof design and all that? So that's all kind of the nuts and bolts. So that might take 1 to 2 months. Then you're ready to submit to the city. Every city kind of has different rules, different guidelines on their submittal process. Sometimes you go planning first. Sometimes you can go straight to the building department. Again, every city is different. It's something you want to know ahead of time. How difficult is the city to get approved? Dean and I were just talking, he's doing a project in Malibu. I would never do a project, well, I would say never. It'd have to be one hell of a project if you want to do it in Malibu, because they just have a reputation for being difficult. Santa Monica, super difficult. Laguna Beach, Santa Barbara, all very difficult. What's that?
West Hollywood.
Okay. So once you know, and you're a little bit hesitant. So it's good to know what you're getting into. So this plan check at the city, the fastest we've ever done is 3 months. 9 months, we just had one in Manhattan Beach, 9 months to get it. Why it takes that long, I don't know, but it's $1 million lot, we're paying interest on it. It's definitely frustrating. If you're in one of these other cities where you have a more complicated process, you've got to go to the planning commission before even submitting, or you've got to go to the design review board, that might add another, it could add 3 months, 6 months, it could even add a year to the project. So Laguna Beach, it might take you 2 years to get your project approved. Go ahead.
What are some of the easier cities to
That's a good question.
Oh my God, yeah, I don't know. I don't know, I mean, city of Los Angeles is not bad.
Yeah, how is Long Beach?
Long Beach is medium. Yeah, they're medium, so.
What about LA County?
Sometimes those can be easier, but the County of Orange is a real pain. So County of LA is not bad. It's not bad. And once you know the personnel and they know you, things can get a little bit easier. But not all the time. City of LA, I mentioned I didn't want to do Santa Monica. I didn't want to do Malibu. We did Pacific Palisades. A lot of development in Pacific Palisades. High-end area, city of LA, much, much easier. We could get the plans approved in 3 to 6 months. So again, you get the same value, but you're not waiting around a year or two to get your plans approved. So big difference. But easy city? North Carolina. 2 to 3 weeks.
What?
2 to 3 weeks, yeah. Plan approval. So Texas, you go in, show them your plans. They say, call us when you're doing the septic tank. We'll come out. That's it. And they'll come out when you're done. That's it. That's all. So much different outside of California. So again, it's a lot of it's the earthquake standards. But
If you had a long escrow, is it legal to submit your plan for plan check during escrow while we're still under the existing owner, or?
You have to get their approval.
Okay.
But typically they're not gonna say no, they want you to buy the lot. So they typically they're not gonna interfere with it. And there's a lot of deals that are contingent upon getting some level of approval by the city. So if you, you know, if you have a lot, let's say up in LA that's zoned multifamily, the deal may be dependent on how many units the city will approve. So you won't know that until the very end. But a lot of times, you know, sellers don't want to wait for that. But every once in a while, you get lucky. Well, they'll wait until the approval process, and then if you don't get it, you can walk from the deal. So, you know, it takes a lot of risk off the table. So then you know, to me, once you get through the city, that's the best part, because then it's up to you. Then you're in charge, you are doing the construction. So typically 6 to 12 months for the construction. If you're doing a basement or something like that, that's gonna add another 6 months. And you're seeing a lot of that up in Santa Monica, a lot of the high-end areas. So that's gonna add definitely to it. And then during that process, you're going to have multiple inspections. You might even have multiple inspectors out on the job. So they're going to check the grading, they're going to check the foundation, framing, electrical, plumbing, drywall. So you're going to have a bunch of inspections out there. Okay.
I thought about that. You're going to North Carolina. The basements you have out here, are they really checking basements as hurricanes and stuff in North Carolina?
It's not mandatory to have it, but again, you know, the advantage of putting one in is you're adding a lot of square footage to the house. So if it's in a nicer area, you're gonna get the value for it. You know, if it's a starter house, you're not gonna get any value for it. You're not gonna put it in. It's still gonna cost you money. So this is kind of a cheat sheet that I use. This is a deal that I didn't do because the guy was stuck on an 875. For the lot, you wouldn't go below it. But this kind of just gives the basics. This is a Excel spreadsheet. So I've got the, you know, it's a proposed 3,000 square foot house. That's what I wanted to pay for the land. This was in Sunset Beach, so it's not a lot of, you know, not a lot of property to land. What's that?
Just curious, the cross streets.
Boy, it was like 26th and Pacific or something.
That's right where
I live. Oh, close. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's
a couple of new construction that just happened.
Yeah, well, maybe volume went down on the price. This was a couple of years ago. So, you know, I've estimated it's a nice area, $200 a square foot. I've got a contingency on there, the permits. It's based on what I expect to pay at the county. This is, even though it's a city of Huntington Beach, it's still under county planning and building, which is kind of interesting. Which in this case was bad because they were going to take a lot longer and be a lot more difficult to deal with in the city of Huntington Beach. So it already came with an architect who was on the high end of the spectrum there. So I've got the loan cost, loan payments, closing when I buy the land, holding cost is something a lot of people ignore. You're going to be paying taxes all the time you're building the property, so you want to add that in the equation. Demo, that was to demolish the existing house. Offsites, any kind of street, sewer improvements, curb gutter, anything you have to put in there, which cities often try to get you to do. This 3,000 square feet. So that's the estimated sales price, less the sales cost. I'm a broker, so I was gonna sell myself. And that's 21%, that's a nice little project, if I had gotten it. 825. Go ahead.
Does the demo include the trash fee as well for all that?
Yeah, basically the demo contractor is just going to give you the whole thing. So this had a small house on it.
How do you do your cost breakdown? Do you redo the numbers based on each different property project, or is it just a spreadsheet and we have a percentage of, you know, is 6% for the demo? 15% for the architect.
It's definitely not set.
Okay.
Every project's gonna be different. You know, so this is a simple
bid out.
Oh yeah.
Those categories.
Yeah. So in my Dropbox, I probably have 100 of these. You know, Sunset Beach House. You know, Huntington Beach, two houses, you know, Big Bear Mansion. Okay. We've got a lot of spreadsheets on them. So they're all similar. And then, you know, more complicated projects can have a bunch more line items for street, sewer, and so this is a very basic, quick, so I, you know, what do I want to offer on this property?
Sir, one thing, you know, it's like he mentioned before, in your hard cost, you stipulated 200 square foot. So that's based on the finishes, because, you know, like if I have a $3,000 square foot home, you know, inches of tile, that's, you know, $1 versus $5, you know, dollar one, or, you know, $150 toilet versus a, you know, $300-$400 one. So this hard cost, you taking into consideration the finishes at
yeah,
some point?
Yeah, definitely. So I'm,
you know,
kind of, I'm looking at the other houses
the
in the area.
Because the architect can tell you, okay, we're going to need, you know, 300 recess lights. What kind? You know, Lutron, or, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It is different. So
well, I'm going to look at what the competition, I mean,
okay.
what's selling in that market?
Okay.
What is, you know, what are the builders building? What are the buyers buying?
Okay.
And I'm going to do the same thing. I'm not going to try to reinvent the wheel. And having done this long enough and written enough checks, when you write a lot of checks, you really figure out what stuff costs pretty quickly. So you know, it's just kind of a standard. This is, you know, this is a high-end area. It's not super high-end, but it's fairly, you know, so that's...
Okay, it's a certain kind of product.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
got
exactly.
It.
So, go ahead.
How much out of pocket are you investing up front for a deal like this? $300,000?
So, you know, initially, you're gonna have your, you know, the architect and the engineer, and then eventually you're gonna have the permits. But this project, you know, almost 1.8, typically a lender is gonna want 25-30%. So you're gonna be putting basically $500,000-$600,000 into it to make $500,000. So you, typically I try to do the deals where by putting in $500,000, I'm making $500,000. So, and with that kind of, you know, profit in there, you can bring in an investor, give them a nice return, and still make a decent profit on it yourself. So what are the risks? Well, planning delays, I talked about some of those cities, you know, that can make or break your project, you know, especially if you were trying, if you were like me and you thought you were really smart and you would take all the money you made building in Signal Hill and Long Beach and LA County and go out to the Inland Empire and getting your projects going in 2003, you thought you were real smart, but when they got stuck at the city for 3 years through the approval process and the market took a turn, then, you know, that can happen. I mean, it can work in your advantage. Obviously, all those years the project was going up, but then at the very end, obviously, things dropped off. So planning delay can help you, but a lot of times it can hurt you if you miss, you know, especially in California where you got a cyclical market. That's one of the huge risks is basically entitlement, getting through City Hall. Neighbors, everybody knows NIMBY, it's a big issue. Signal Hill, I told you the story, a lot of neighbors, you know, were opposed to building anything on these vacant lots, even though they were zoned residential, they just didn't want to see anything. And they have obviously the right to show up at City Hall and say whatever they want for 3 minutes. But that's an issue, you know, the larger the project, the more likely you are to have opposition. And in a lot of areas, it's going to be people are concerned about the noise, the traffic, etc. If you want to do a low income housing project, then you're really going to get a lot of opposition. So moratorium zoning changes. These kind of things can happen. I knew a project in Huntington Beach. The guy got a 14-unit townhome project approved. The city said, oh no, we're going to zone your property commercial. Ended up in litigation, and he ended up winning, but cost him a lot of money, and then he had to go back to the city to get approval. So, you know, these kind of things. Moratorium, we were building in Big Bear, drought. City says, oh, we're not giving out any more water meters. So, good luck selling a house without a water meter. So we had to wait. Fortunately, it was the end of the year, and we were first in line for the New Year's, but we had to wait 4 months in order for the new fiscal year to start so we could get our water meter and go ahead with the project. So these are the kind of things, construction delays. We had an issue in Signal Hill. Again, it was a view issue. one of the tenants across the street said, oh, you're blocking my view, even though she was looking down on our property. I don't know what it was a view of, but she called City Hall. They came out, they red tagged the project. I had to go back out, shoot all the photos, show everybody, have the city council members over. You know, it was ridiculous, but you know, these kind of things can happen in construction. Recourse loans. Most construction loans are recourse loans. So anybody, commercial recourse loans mean not only can they take the property back, but they can go after you personally for any shortage or any liability. So that was one of the most depressing days in my career, is when I read the fine print on the loan documents that talked about, oh yeah, basically we're gonna sue you and there's no defense, there's nothing you can do. So fortunately I got out of it. But recourse loans is an issue. Sometimes you can mitigate that. You can say, I'll be liable, but only up to a certain amount. But that, again, many times you can negotiate your way out, but that's how the banks try to squeeze on you. So I mean, it's hard to avoid a recourse loan. California, 10-year construction liability on new construction.
10 years?
Yeah. So it's not, there's the law that governs that is SB 800. So it's not every component is covered for 10 years. There's specific coverages for plumbing and so forth. But you know, on a condominium building, you have these condominiums that are 9 years old. These attorneys will show up and have a big barbecue picnic for everybody and go, hey, who wants to make some extra money by suing the developer? So, you know, this is a big issue. The fortunate thing is there's insurance, you can insure around it. So you're not, you know, you don't end up on the hook for it, but you gotta know which insurance to get. So you can lose money. 2008, very hard if you were a developer to not lose money. The key was to not lose all your money and get voted off Real Estate Island. The key was to save a little money so you could keep going. So I did lose a lot of money, but fortunately not all of it, and I was able to keep going right through, starting right back in 2009 again. So those are restful rewards. You're creating places for people to live, work, play. It's very rewarding. First time homebuyers. This is one of the most enjoyable parts of being a builder, is dealing with the first time homebuyers. This is their dream home. This is, people get so excited. There's screaming, crying. I mean, it can get very, very emotional how happy some people get with the house. So that is, to me, one of the, I'm getting like goosebumps just talking about it. So that to me is one of the most rewarding things. Obviously, you're creating jobs, you're benefiting the economy. I mean, developing, you're spending a lot of money. So that goes to the next one, mileage points. So I used to buy all my materials on American Express card. So we're talking hundreds of thousands of dollars in materials. That's a lot of vacations after you finish your project and sell it and get out. So that was a big plus for a while. It can be challenging. I mean, you're basically creating something from scratch. You have this, you have a lot, you basically, that's your canvas to paint on. So to me, I like, if you're designing a house, the outside, the floor plan, you know, that you get to use some of your creative brain. You know, we've all seen those architectural guidelines. Well, if you're doing high-end homes, you actually get to build that home and put that kitchen and put that bathroom your home, so you have a bigger budget. It could be a lot of fun designing and actually building those houses, and you can make a lot of money. So I'll give you the upside. 2003-2004, I probably made $3-4 million. One project in the city of Signal Hill, two lots, bought it from an oil company who had abandoned their oil wells, and at the time houses were selling for $800,000 each. So I thought I'd build those two houses and I'd make $300,000 profit. Well, by the time I was done, those houses were selling for $1.3 million. So my $300,000 profit went to $1.3 million. So that's the upside. Another project, a guy was building 200 houses in Ventura around a golf course. So it's a long process to get this project approved. So when he started out, houses in that area selling for $500,000. So he thought, time he gets done, he's going to build 200 houses, he's going to make $100,000. By the time the project was completed, $1 million for each of those houses. So $20 million project turned into $100 million projects. If you hit the timing, this is the beauty of California. It's definitely a boom bust state. If you hit it right, you can make a lot of money. So what are the opportunities? Obviously, now that you guys are educated, you know what to look for, you know what to do. Finding deals, if you want to cross something, don't ignore it. Call me, call somebody else, or do it yourself. I mean, those are two of the choices. Partnering with a property owner. So I talked about the deal in Sunset Beach. If that property owner had owned that property free and clear, you wouldn't have to bring any money into that deal. You've got a free and clear lot. You can go to the bank. You could be the developer. You get the architect. You get the engineer. You design it. You figure out the numbers. You hire the contractor. Homeowner puts up the land. You build it. You split the profit. Fantastic way. I know a lot of people that do that. On a smaller scale, 2-1 house in a nice neighborhood, adding a master bedroom and bath. Great way to add a tremendous amount of value. Only makes sense if it's an area where houses are selling probably $300 and higher. If you know houses are selling for $150 a foot and you're spending $125 a foot to build an addition, it's just not worth your time. So a high-end neighborhood, that's gonna work great. Also, taking a single story in a high-end neighborhood, building a second story on it, another way to make a lot of money. Entitling land, so again, that's taking the land. It could be just a single family home and designing a bigger house, selling it to a developer. We had a project in the Palisades. It's a tear down house. It was a 3,000 square foot house on a 15,000 square foot lot. We designed a 9,000 square foot house. Decided, hey, we don't like where the market's going. We sold it to some guy who had just gotten his company bought by Google, had $60 million. Always wanted to live on that street. We made $500,000 without actually building the house. So again, that could be another option.
Do you find that when you get bid from contractors for building one, two-story, close to one, do they charge you a higher premium? Is that kind of just kind of bogus markup, or that just really what the industry standard is in terms of price per square foot?
Well, you know, surprisingly, one story is more expensive often. You've got more roof space, you've got a bigger foundation area, but you know, you have less, obviously less framing, engineering, but oftentimes it can be a little bit more. It's not, but then again, you don't have to have as much scaffolding to go up, so a lot of it is offset. But there's a huge market. I mean, everybody wants one story. So you can actually get a premium, when you go to sell, because there's very, very little new construction one-story houses on there. But a lot of it depends on, you know, what the engineering is on it. But oftentimes, the two-story can be a little bit less expensive. So investing in a development deal, that's what I did the first time. I didn't know what I was doing. I invested with another guy who was developing in Long Beach. And I kind of just went along for the ride and showed up more than I probably should have at the job, but I learned a lot along the way, so it worked out too. So that's another way to learn a little bit more and make a little money. And you know, the nice thing on the development side, because the profit is a little higher, we typically pay for our investors 20% annually in return. So it's not a bad way to make some money. So who do you need on the team? Obviously, you need an architect. On a less complicated project, you can use a draftsman. Usually the architect draftsman already has an engineer that they work with, so you don't have to choose that person, and they're gonna work together to get the project designed. It goes to City Hall, there's gonna be some corrections, it goes back to the architect, goes back to the engineer, and then back to the city. So they're gonna be definitely involved at the start. Also, when you're under construction, if there's an issue with the framing or foundation, the building inspector has a question, they may get called out to the field to go look at what you're actually building and make sure it's meeting the plans, or possibly something has to be re-engineered. So they may be very involved after the design, or they just do the design and they're done with the project. So contractor, they're going to be involved throughout. So I've got contractors. You might have one contractor to put in the roads and infrastructure, sewer, water, et cetera, and then your general contractor to actually build the building or build the house. And then if you're feeling ambitious and brave and you want to do it yourself, be an owner builder, then you're going to be hiring and finding all the subcontractors. Typically, home construction, you're going to be dealing with 27 to 30 different trades are going to be involved. So there's a lot of people going to be on the phone a lot, trust me, coordinating. And then you got to put out the squabbles between all the different contractors who are blaming, you know, the drywall guy blames the framer blames the electrician who, you know, cut some of their wood to put in there. So it goes on and on. Yeah. There has to be, you have to be the adult on the job. So civil engineer, this is going to become an issue if you're building on a hillside lot. You're going to have to design a more engineered foundation. If you're doing a subdivision where you've got to put in a road, water lines, sewer lines, light poles, fire hydrants, et cetera, you're going to have a civil engineer involved in designing those. Lender, obviously going to be critical unless you've got a rich uncle. Soils engineer, this is what Matt was talking about. It's a big issue in California, obviously. We've got liquefaction issues in some areas. We've got earthquake issues everywhere. So typically, as part of the project, we'll hire a soils engineer. Typically, you're going to spend $2,000 or $3,000. They're actually going to go out to the property. They're going to bore some holes. They're going to test the soil, and that's going to dictate how the foundation is designed for the property. Yeah, we did actually build in Long Beach on a property that was formerly a gas station. And there is a whole other level of engineering. Phase one, that's if you suspect. Phase one is where they go out and analyze the history of the property to determine if there's any likelihood there was any contamination on it in the past. And if there is, then you do a phase two, which is a whole another round of testing. And then at that point, you may want to, like, hey, I'm not so interested in your
long. How much does something like that cost? When you saw audit, the whales you gave for the audit company, that the environmental remediation company, they were killing, you know, doing that kind of work. But, you know, have you ever dealt with that, having to remediate land and like that in the past? It's like a building in Tennessee that I've been interested in forever, but it's been vacant for like 10 years because it was a gas station next door and there was major environmental issues. I don't know if they have to tear down all the building or what they would need to do.
I know there was a list of people about the house. There was a little paving place. They pulled that place down. They dug like 12 feet into that house. So crazy.
It can be very time consuming. I mean, where the testing can go over years. it takes a long time for the soil to get to the point where.
That's just testing,
that
level of remediation, right?
Right. Well, that's part of the remediation. The testing can be done, but then there's a remediation plan which can take, you know, a decade.
So test it, remediate,
keep going back. Yeah. So it can be an on. So we bought this property at the very end of the remediation, where it was about ready to get signed off, and so that was part of the deal. It's contingent upon the complete sign-off and all that. But I've done a lot of building in Signal Hill, and you had a lot of oil left over and sometimes in the soil. So that has to be scraped out or removed. And so but that's a much smaller scale.
Have you ever had a problem where on the hillside there were a lot of oak trees and you're not supposed to crush them? I had. And like the tree huggers,
yeah.
They were there.
Yeah. Yeah, well, we've had it. We basically end up designing around the house. We build some houses in Big Bear. It was the same thing.
You take one, you have to transplant something with the same canopy size. That's a nightmare.
Yeah. Well, I was looking at a project in Laguna Beach that had an endangered plant on it. So because you were going to remove some, you had to take that, transplant it to some other property and pay a guy $2,500 a month to like go water that plant. And then it had to be for 10 years after the project was done.
And then if you take the tree...
Yeah, I didn't do that project. I was like, forget, this is crazy.
If you take the tree, the soil now is not stable enough. You know, that goes to the site engineering. I mean, I had a project in CDM LA, it took me 2 years just for the size report because of the old trees.
Big Bear, you've got pine trees. If it's, you have to measure the circumference, and if it's over 8 inches, you can't remove it. Or you have to, you know, so you basically have to run around the lot measuring all the trees and figuring out where you're going to put the house.
And you know, another thing is, you ever going to work with bamboos? Be really careful with that thing before you plant the bamboo.
Grows fast.
Yes, and it grows like this.
Yeah.
So it can go under a house and I mean, leaves it. I mean, it's ugly. So make sure the person knows what they're doing.
Yeah, agreed.
If you're putting your lines in there,
yeah, oh yeah.
Say if you find a team that are all for under a foundation, is there a certain type of soil you recommend that's good for the place on the
We, you know, the native soil, I mean,
it's probably going to have some house of orange and has some medium expensive soil, so it gets wet.
Yeah. So typically that might actually be removed during a different time. I mean, there's a lot of different soils you can use, but it has to be able to be compact so that it doesn't do that. You know, you don't want any movement, you know, either under a foundation or next to a retaining wall. So it's definitely going to be an issue. So that sometimes, you're digging everything out and recompacting it, but the soil's not. Can't be recompacted, then it's got to be removed. So, I mean, there's guys who make a living as dirt brokers, you know. Some guy is trying to get rid of dirt, another guy needs dirt, there's a guy in the middle, like, hey, I got dirt, you know. So sometimes you've got to buy dirt, and sometimes you can sell your dirt, so, you know, it just depends. So it's all supply and demand. So just like anything else. But then it's got to be tested to make sure it's clean and you're not giving some contaminated soil or selling it. So surveyor, they're going to come out, they're going to survey your lot, show you where your lot lines are. A lot of times they're not where your neighbor's fence is. It's on your property, or you know, you also don't want to build on your neighbor's property, so this can be a big issue. Also, you want to make sure you build your house in the right spot, because if you're in the setback, the city can make you tear your house down. So you don't want to do it. I mean, usually they're going to catch it when you're getting ready to pour the foundation. But again, then you have to tear all everything down and redo it. So you want to make sure you're building in the right spot. So utility consultants, basically, again, in a bigger project, you know, you've got to bring in all the utilities. So you've got to deal with SCE. You know, they might want another pole. They might want, you know, another substation. They might want you to move one of their poles over in order for your development to get done. You've got cable, you've got gas. So a lot of times, if you want to deal with all that, you can hire people who used to work at all these different agencies to kind of act as a go-between and get the plans done. So you have one less thing on your plate. So, and then obviously a realtor to help you with your value. So big thing. This is for all types of real estate investing. You got to know your market. I see this all the time, you know. Rough area, somebody's got to build Taj Mahal right there, you know. I mean, and they end up losing, you know, they're losing their shirt on it. And, you know, I see it time and time again. So you always want to build your market. You don't want to overspend. You're not going to live there. You know, find out what's selling. Find out what you can build and make a profit on. You don't have to have your favorite granite in there. So again, like this house on the left, you're not going to build that on the neighborhood on the right. And the other way around, you don't want to go too cheap either. So you don't want to do the house in the middle on the lot on the left-hand side. That doesn't make any sense. You're not maximizing the value of the property. This I've got a picture of the stove over there. I built a couple condos in Brentwood, and the guy who bought one of the first ones said at the very end, you know, you put in GE profile appliances. If you had put Viking appliances in, I would have paid $100,000 more for the property. Well, I was like, oh. So lesson, yeah, expensive lesson learned there. Again, doing a lot of projects in Pacific Palisades, you've got a very picky buyer, high end. They like what they like, they don't like what they don't like. So the kiss of death is for you have open house and they walk in and people go, oh, this is a Mar Vista house. No offense if anyone's from Mar Vista here. That's the kiss of death. Oh, it's a Mar Vista house, forget it. And up in a market like that, they're not just gonna pay less. People aren't gonna buy your house. They're gonna go, we just don't like this house. They're not gonna buy it. You're gonna end up ripping all that stuff out and putting it in. I've seen it over and over again. So you can't go to an area and say, well, I know this is how we do it, and we'll show these guys how we do it. It doesn't make sense. You wanna build to your market. So how do you learn about your market? Obviously, you drive around, you look at the comps, you see what other people are doing, you go to open houses. I've walked lots of open houses. You see what kind of finishes, how many bedrooms, what are the properties selling for, what are they doing in the backyard as far as landscaping, patios, all that kind of thing. Talk to the local realtors. Usually there's a lot of realtors who specialize in new development. You'll see the same guys listing new projects over and over again. They obviously know the market. You go online. I mean, we all the time, we look and go, okay, what kind of marble is everybody using? What kind of cabinets is everybody putting in? So, pay attention to industry trends. Travertine, it's out. It's out, people. Don't put travertine in anymore. It may come back, but don't take a chance. And, you don't want to reinvent the wheel. Subdivisions, they build the same house because it sells, makes money. That's why you see it. Do what works.
What do you think is the best way to try to find a piece of land to develop if you're trying to search for land to build on?
For any kind of real estate, I just do the shotgun approach. You look online, you look on LoopNet, you talk to people. I mean, everybody knows somebody, uncle, brother, cousin, friend, who's got some land, or they come across it, and they know you, they know what you do. Obviously, networking is big.
Out there, tell people what you're looking for.
But typically, we deal with a couple of brokers who are really good. They really know new construction, and they find deals. And that's just worked better than anything else. But definitely word of mouth. I mean, usually when I speak at an event like this, I get a bunch of calls like, hey, I got this land, what do you think?
How do you find those types of brokers? What do you think they would be recommending?
Well, they're the ones who are selling it, they're the ones that are working for builders, and they'll, then there's a little bit about, hey, don't tell him, tell me. If you can, find somebody you're compatible with and you work well with, it can be a great team. And they're gonna, they're finding it, they're making money on the front end, and they're making money on the back end. So it's very, trust me, my guy's made a lot of money. A lot of money. He's not happy with North Carolina. That's the way it goes. So we were talking about the budget. So you're gonna get bids on the plans, and those should be apples to apples. But the more detail they put on there, the better you're gonna be able to tell if you're getting what's on the plan and they're bidding the same as the next guy. But then when you get into the finishes, you can call out all the finishes, you can do your scope of work where you say, I want Kohler, model 101B chrome for the bathrooms. I mean, you can get into that detail. And if you do, then you're gonna get a much more representative bid of what you want. But you can also just get an allowance for these different fixtures. So all the different contractors bid without allowance for the electrical fixtures, for the plumbing fixtures, and so forth. So again, that way your bid is apple to apples. Hopefully your allowance covers what you want, and that's why you want to do your homework. So you've looked at the competition, you've seen what level of finishes they're doing. You can go online. I do a ton of shopping online. just to see what the prices are for these fixtures, so we can have the amount and the budget. And let, you know, the contractor is going to submit a budget. There's going to be some back and forth. You know, his number may be too high for, you know, where you can make money on the project. You know, where can we cut? Where can we add? You know, that's a lot of it. Just like flipping houses, you want to look like, you know, you've added a lot of value, but you haven't spent that amount of money. So it's all, you know, it's all about doing it right, but also making some money.
You mentioned about the models. So you were buying them over the
community, right? So. Yeah, well, I was, you know, I'm a general contractor. So some of the projects, I was acting as the contractor, and so I was buying them. But a lot of times too, you know, some of the things, you know, your tile, your cabinets, you can pay that. You're going to buy that directly because those have to be ordered ahead of time. So you can, you know, you can either pay the contractor or you can just pay it directly. So
when you're dealing with, you know, perfect person to ask is your contractor, you partner, you know, what are the things to watch out for when you are partnering with your contractor or something like that?
Hold that thought.
Okay.
It's coming. So scope of work, okay, so that's detailing out, you know, what actually is going to go in the house. You know, on an average house, Home Depot, Lowe's, we buy a lot of fixtures at Lamps Plus. There's plumbing suppliers who have all the different brands of plumbing fixtures, so you can kind of see what you like and get the pricing on it. Shopping online, I said, partnering with a contractor. Obviously, you partner with a contractor, you make them do all this work. So. One less thing for you. So here we go. See, look at you. Construction management. You know. Never do I go to a party where I tell people I'm in construction that I get out of there without people telling me their horror stories. So it can be, you know, it can work out well or it can be an absolute nightmare. So choose wisely. So general contractor versus owner builder. If you're building a house for yourself, you can actually pull the permit and be the contractor of record on the job. So comparing them, do you have the time, do you have the personality, do you want to deal with 30 different subs who some may try to rip you off or get away with stuff that if you have more experience they couldn't get away with? You know, it's not going to be easy. I once saw a TV show where this couple talked about they've been married 25 years and they'd remodel their kitchen 3 times, and they were more proud that the marriage had lasted through the 3 kitchen remodels. So, it can be stressful for sure. Contractors, obviously, they already know, you know, sometimes they know the inspectors, they have the know-how, they have the contacts, they know all the subcontractors, they get better deals from the suppliers, they have the insurance in place, workers comp, bonds, warranties, so forth. So owner builder, if you pull a permit, you're not supposed to sell the house within a 12-month period. So people do it all the time and get away with it. So.
That SB 800 or SB 80, where you have the
800, yeah.
Where you guarantee it for 10 years, is that against the contractor or against you as a developer? If there's a
developer.
It's the developer. So yeah. It doesn't matter. So do you have any recourse against the contractor at that point, even though it's 10 years?
Yeah. Well, that, you know, that's where you have the contract. With the contractor, you dictate what contract the contractor has with the subcontractors with all the language, correct language in it, and then you make sure everybody's got insurance and you as a developer can actually get the right insurance. So I'll talk about that in a little bit. So again, how much are you saving? In the long run, you know, oftentimes you may not be saving much at all. So how are we doing? Okay. So this is a risk. Flipping houses, even bigger risk on development. Obviously, things can happen. There's a lot of people working. There's a lot of power tools. You got a lot going on. People building up on second stories, roofs. Very, very dangerous. You know, I've definitely seen my share of accidents on the job site. It's only, you know, it's only a matter of time before something happens. So, you know, that could wipe out your whole project, could wipe you out financially if someone died on a job that was not covered under workers' comp. Lack of skill workmanship. The first new house I built, I used all the guys I was using for flipping houses, disaster. They didn't know the code, didn't work out. So you've got a whole nother list of subcontractors you gotta deal with. And they're not licensed, then you've got even bigger issues because they don't know the code, and you potentially could have stuff ripped out and redone. The inspector doesn't like it. So again, they're not going to have liability insurance if you have that same issue. If there's a liability down the road, it's going to go back to you because they're not going to have any insurance for it. And in California, unlicensed worker, they're supposed to be on payroll. So if you're paying them cash, 1099, franchise tax board, who's worse than the IRS, finds out, you're going to have a whole other issue right there. So finding good contractors, you know, good luck. Definitely, obviously, referrals are a great way to go. Somebody who's worked for a friend, co-worker, so forth, that's worth its weight in gold. I've actually found a lot, not contractors, but subcontractors on Craigslist, specialty things like a fence guy or some guy who does iron work. I've actually found a lot of good guys on Craigslist. Angie's List is another good one. Building Industry Association has lists of their members, and the Blue Book is like a Yellow Pages for contractors. So, and it's a free resource. So all those are great ways to find it, but definitely a referral is the best way to go. So choose the right one. Well, if you got the scope of work, you got the budget, you're gonna know if you're bidding apples to apples. Obviously, you're gonna wanna get at least, I'd say, 3 bids on each project. Lowest bid is not always the best. That probably goes without saying. Again, if it's too low, you may end up paying for it on the back end, or it's just gonna be a bunch of change orders and you're gonna end up paying the same amount. So, this, again, it's a specialty. You're not going to want to use the same guys who you use on your flips. And level quality has to balance with the budget. So again, don't build the wrong house in the wrong neighborhood. And you've got to be, you know, there's got to be a connection with whoever you're going to use. I mean, you're going to be in business for a long time with this person. And there's a lot of decisions that have to be made. There's going to be probably some issues along the way. So it's got to be someone you're compatible with, comfortable communicating, because that's going to be a key to having a successful project. So how long have they been in business? They have a staff. They have someone to do the paperwork. Contractors are famous for being very bad on the paperwork, and that can be a problem later on, especially if you have any change orders. So do they have referrals from other clients? Can you go look at some of their work and see what they've actually done? That is critical. You can check online, do they actually have a license? Is there a license active? There's the website to do that. You would be surprised how many guys are out there running around who are not licensed, or they're working under somebody else's license. Well, there's definitely an easy way to find out and get their insurance, get their workers' comp, make sure they're covered so that you're covered. Definitely sign a contract. I mean, that just goes without saying. So what's going to be in the contract? Price. A couple different ways. You can have a total price. Here's my plans. Here's the scope of work. This is what I want. Contract comes back. I'll do the whole thing for $250,000. The other way is a cost plus a fee. So it's whatever all materials and labor costs, they're going to add on typically 15 to 18% on top of that. And that's typically what we do as a cost plus a fee. We're kind of, you know, have been doing it for a while, so we're comfortable with the costs, and it makes sense for us. There's no usually less surprises. You're going to add your scope of work to the contract. Change orders. This is inevitable on every job. There's going to be changes. You're going to want to see changes made to the finishes. You know, maybe you know the market's going up. You want to do a little nicer house, make a little extra money. Or there's going to be some issue with the plans. Change orders, you've got to get them in writing. You know, if you start saying, oh yeah, do that, you know, at the end of the job, your budget's 10% higher, or there's going to be a dispute. I said this, you heard this, and you know, it can be a nightmare. Start, end date, last thing you want to do is hire a guy, and then you call him up, like, hey, when are you starting? Oh, I got 3 other jobs, I'll get to you next month. Right there, you want that in the contract. When are you starting? They don't start, gives you an excuse to fire them. Just certain milestones, that's the expectations. You're gonna, you know, framing's gonna be done by this period of time. House will be done, we'll have a certificate of occupancy, so forth. insurance that's spelled out, typically $1 million general liability coverage in California is adequate. Subcontractor, are they going to require insurance from their subcontractor? Are they going to, you know, have a contract with their subcontractors? All that's you want spelled out. So this is the kind of thing you want to hire an attorney, spend $1,500, get the contract done, get it right, and then you've got a contract you can use, you know, over and over again. So the draw schedule is basically when they're getting paid. Biggest mistake a lot of people make is paying too much money too soon to the contractor, especially toward the end of the job. You want to hold some money back so you can get them on the phone and get them back to the job finished, because if not, that money's being used on their next job. So this, the draw schedule is going to say when you're getting paid and how much you're getting paid.
Do you think, I've seen a lot of contractors, but they get 20% up front, so they can go buy a bunch of materials and all that stuff. Do you recommend not doing that and making them pay for it first and then showing the work done before that happens, or how does that typically work?
Well, things like the cabinets, the tile, flooring, that has to be paid up front.
Okay.
So two things you can do. I mean, you can pay for it directly, or you can do a joint check to the contractor and the supplier. So on some of those items, that's okay. But generally speaking, no. For you know, most materials, you're not going to be paying in advance for them, especially at the beginning of the job. So insurance, lien releases, you know, these are all kind of the minutiae that goes into a contract. Big thing, you know, incentives and penalties. So I want you to build this house. If you get it done in 7 months, we'll give you an extra $10,000, $15,000, it depends. If it's a high-end home, you might be paying $20,000 in interest to the bank. If the guy gets it done a month early, you'll be happy to pay him $10,000 to do it. More likely, you're going to have the stick. So if it's not done in this period of time, you're paying X amount per day that it's not done, which can be effective. Contractors don't like it. They don't like it, but it happens. It happens a lot. And what is the warranty? So how long are they going to cover the their work? And that's going to be true not only the general, but the, you know, the roofing contractor, the stucco guy. How long is their work warranty for?
Windows.
What's that?
Windows.
Yeah. All the materials and so forth. So, and then out cost, you know, what has to happen so that you can fire them without ending up in a big big litigation. So managing the job, you got to get out there, you got to go see the job, make sure it's getting done. And a lot of times, you know, now modern technology, you can have pictures taken, but I still say go to the job minimum one time, maybe probably twice a week. You know, if you don't understand what's going on, ask questions, you know, communicate. The worst thing you can do is the contractor goes, okay, I need to put shower valves in. What kind of shower fixtures do you want to use? That's not the point where you want to spend 2 weeks going, I don't know, I like the Kohler, but the Moen's kind of nice too. You're going to slow the job down. You're going to drive the contractor absolutely crazy. So do some of your homework ahead of time, so that you know, and there should be a schedule, so you know, and if you're communicating, the contractor's like, hey, I need to know the plumbing fixtures next Tuesday, so, go ahead.
When you're visiting your site regularly, like you're doing on statement, how often do I ask that if you're not staying?
Yeah, that project, I may spend a lot of time out there. I may go out there for a couple weeks at a time.
You know,
what's up? I've got some friends out there too, so I'm gonna have them kind of, you know, pay them to go by the job site as well. So, you know, some kind of combination of that. So, yeah.
Are you trying FaceTime for that?
What's that?
Are you trying FaceTime for that? So you have FaceTime all of them?
No, it's a great idea. You gotta have your contractor savvy enough to figure out FaceTime. But,
he's gonna hide part of it. The
lighting's like gonna be perfect.
No, it's actually a great idea. I've had them take video, but I haven't actually FaceTimed, so that's not a bad idea. So again, I just mentioned paying, some of the materials need to be paid for in advance, and that's okay. Stick to your budget as much as possible. You know, you can get nickel and dime to death, and before you know it, you're way, way over budget, so be very, very careful. Surprises are inevitable, so you're going to have your contingency in there. And if you need to, you gotta be willing to fire a contractor, even if it's a little messy. So, liability insurance, you as the owner or developer, you've got to be named as the additional insurer on the insurance policy. That way you're covered. So this is a typical $1 million coverage per occurrence. And they have $2 million total coverage for all their jobs. These are the ratings. You want to be AM Best rated A+ or A++. Insurance companies are all going to want to make sure you've got a contract with the contractor. They've got contracts with the subs. They've all got the right language in there. So again, that's why I suggest having an attorney help you at least the first time. Completed operations. This is sometimes some insurance policies will only cover the contractor while he's working on the place, not once the house is done. So that would be a huge mistake on a new construction project. So it's got to be completed operations. Waiver of subrogation, you don't want to get into that.
What's waiver of subrogation?
Oh, really? It basically has to do with who are you suing first, the general contractor versus the subcontractors, and whose attorney's on top of it. Yeah.
Liability first.
Yeah. Basically, who's in the line of fire first, but typically in a construction project, everybody gets sued, and everybody sits around a table, and the plaintiff goes, okay, how much can we get out of you, drywall guy, and then you go, so usually everybody coughs up money, and the problem goes away. Yeah, that's why you gotta have the right coverage. So getting a copy of the whole contract, a lot of insurance policies have exclusions. I had a deal where a buddy of mine was the contractor. He was working on a new house, but his policy did not cover new construction. It ended up construction liability, huge issue. Even though it excluded it, they still ended up coughing up some money, but only after I wrote a big check at the end. So that was a painful experience. So now I get the whole policy. And if you have an insurance agent, part of what they'll do is review the contractor's insurance policy and all the subs' insurance policies and make sure they have the right coverage, they have the right level of insurance, it's a rated company and so forth. So you pay a little bit, but highly worth it. You don't want to be spending your time doing that. And it's not required, but trust me, it's a very, very good idea to have. So workers' comp is to cover any employee on a job. The owner of the company is exempt. So you're exempt if you're the owner or the owner of the subcontracting company who often do work on the job, they're exempt. California State Fund is probably the most common type of workers' comp. The rate's going to depend. A roofer is going to pay a lot higher workers' comp rate, which is a percentage of the payroll, than a painting contractor. So that can be an issue and affect bids. You know, accidents do happen, and lack of coverage, slip and fall is going to end up in a lawsuit. And you as a developer, you're going to be right in the crosshairs. So other insurance policy, auto policy, sometimes that's required. The guys are going on and off the job site, so you've got to be additional insured on their auto policy. Course of construction is the policy covering the building while it's being built. Fire, theft, it's kind of like a homeowner's policy for a construction project. Construction bond is going to be required on the infrastructure. The city is going to want you to bond, assuring them that you're going to put in all the required public improvements. Developer gap, that's what I was talking about earlier. That's for the developer. That's your additional policy. That if you know the subs policies, if the subs company goes out of business, the sub goes out of business, you've got an additional policy that's going to cover you. We pay about $8,000 to $10,000, but you really sleep a lot better at night.
Per project or per year?
Per house. So another, it's just another cost. But you know, if you're dealing in a high-end area, a lot of litigation, you want to be covered. It's definitely worth it. So mechanics liens, this is a big part of construction. The subcontractors, the material suppliers have a right to lien the property if you don't pay for the material. So they're gonna send out a preliminary notice, so when you pay for the supplies, when you pay the subcontractors, you're gonna wanna get lien releases. There's a conditional release on progress payment if you haven't paid them all the money. Unconditional release when you're all done. So if you have a lender, they're going to want to see those before they start paying out any money. Often, you know, subs complain they don't get paid, they think they should have got paid more. They'll file liens even though they haven't followed all the laws. But you still have an issue, you want to sell the house, it's got a lien on it, you've got to negotiate your way out of it. So it's definitely something you want to pay on top of and not, you know, trying to negotiate it out so they don't file lien on the property, because once it's there, it's harder to get rid of. The remedy actually for a subcontractor or supplier doesn't get paid is actually to foreclose on your property. So they have that right to do that. So it's something that you don't want to just blow off. It's not likely unless it's a big dollar amount, but it does happen. And another way to avoid it, obviously you pay directly to the sub, or you can do a joint check to the contractor and the supplier.
You got a complete list of every sub they use
beforehand? No, but as the project is going on, you're gonna get before, you know, you always make it before anybody gets paid. I want their liability policy naming me as additional insurer, their workers' comp naming me. I want all their policies. And then, you know, when they request a payment, they're submitting an invoice, these are the materials and so forth. So
you get the policy from every sub.
Absolutely. Yeah, definitely. You know, without a doubt. And that, you know, you have that over them, like, oh, you want to get paid? Oh, I didn't get the paperwork. Sorry, I can't pay you. My boss will. Trust me, you get the paperwork. So the last thing, notice of completion. This ends the lien period. So this is filed with the county recorder. And this is also true on a rehab addition. You want to do the notice of completion. So you're basically putting everybody on notice that the job is done, send it to the general contractor, and that shortens the lien period. There's only a certain amount of time after the project's done that the contractors can do a lien, even though I did have one guy file a lien 5 years after the house was done. And I'm like, dude, seriously? But he did. Attorney letter, he got rid of him. So that's it, that's me. That is my information, that's my company, and obviously always looking for more deals and always looking for investors on our deals. So, I don't know, are we out of time?
Oh, we have questions if you guys want questions.
Definitely. How can we get the slides?
I'll have them emailed to me and then we'll put them on meetup.com so you guys can just download them right directly. So,
yeah, or that's
we can just give you the email.
No problem. Go ahead.
We're looking for deals for you. Do you want us to use a spreadsheet to kind of go over your profit margins and whatnot that you have on the slideshow?
Oh, the I don't have any problem.
Great.
To the Excel?
Yeah.
I got a pretty basic one that's kind of,
right.
I mean, it's general, but it'll get the job done.
Right.
At least you figure out if you're in the ballpark.
Right.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Do you have any thoughts or insight about the proposed demansionizing of the in Los Angeles?
It's horrible.
Do you know anything that's wrong with it?
Well, I mean, that's already passed.
It's already passed.
In LA, what's that?
What is it?
It's just restrictions on the size of properties.
It's the lot size, right?
It's based on the lot size, based on the location. Some areas are subject to it, some areas are not.
It's already passed.
City of LA, yeah. Yeah, I mean, other cities are passing them. You know, there's obviously some pushback on some of the, you know, when development starts getting, you know, happening quickly, people get a little nervous, uptight, so they start going, let's slow stuff down.
Is that just new construction, or is it the tear down everything but two walls?
Which is basically both.
Both?
Yeah, because that's, you know, if you're rebuilding more than half the house, you're going to fall in that category.
You're going to fall in that category.
Yeah.
What is the typical risk on
you? So with a bank, you know, right now, like 6-6.5%, and then private lender, 9-10%. Hard money type loan. Yeah. So difficult to get a bank loan. They're still pretty restricted, but it's starting to loosen up a little bit.
What's your favorite bank?
What's that?
Do you have any other references for banks? Some changes or which bank do you usually deal with?
Generally, the smaller banks are easier to deal with. I've never done one with a major bank. So we used to use Pacific Western Bank for all loans. We use Farmers and Merchants a lot. So we found those guys by just getting on the phone. East West Bank used to be very aggressive lender.
Smaller local banks are always your best bet. I got a 4.75% point rate on a $550,000 construction loan on an apartment building. It was awesome. But, you know, it's a long-term type deal, though, too, you know, so. It just depends on the bank and how well they know the area.
Yeah, a lot of the smaller banks that were loaning in 2008 got taken over by the FDIC, so they're no longer in business. Yeah.
Do you focus mostly on like high end properties, or do you do anything?
That's actually a good question. So I worked in the city of Long Beach in affordable housing, so we've actually done a lot of first time home buyer type project, entry level starter homes. And then the high-end homes, So I had a period where I was literally looking at projects in Inglewood, driving by our development in Inglewood, and then heading off to the Pacific Palisades. So it definitely both ends of the spectrum. So much, yeah, which I like. I like both of them.
Are you still building both high-end and mid-tier during this market, like right now?
In California, yeah. I'm just doing one project, high-end, and the houses in North Carolina are all entry level. So they'll be like 1,800 square feet and we'll sell them $295. Yeah. Yeah.
Can you alluded to something you're doing the 3D printing? Can you kind of give a quick overview on that?
Yeah, I mean, it's basically supposedly the future of construction. And, if you go on YouTube and look, there's a couple of Chinese companies that have built houses using a giant 3D printer, some kind of composite material where it's just going back and forth, building the walls up.
Layer after layer after layer. It's pretty interesting, actually.
I mean, it seems like it's inevitable. I mean, that houses are going to be built either in a factory. I mean, there already obviously are modular homes, but that's just going to become more and more common.
Just a structural.
They're doing the whole frame and everything of the house is what it looked like in the video.
It's just building the wall out of a composite material that's basically, comes out of a like an inkjet type thing where it's going back and forth and around and building the walls and interior walls. So it's pretty cool. It's good. I mean, the houses are ugly, but the technology is just starting. And I honestly think, that the future is going to be there. And like Matt said, it may totally disrupt the construction industry.
In the past 3 years in Southern California, what's the quickest you can take a project from close
to
escrow to
a
certificate of occupancy?
11 months. That's pretty good.
That was in Pacific Palisades?
That was in Torrance. No, well, we did want it about 13 months in the process. This is, again, the city of LA is fast. You're in a high-end area, but you don't have planning. You don't have to go to planning commission. You don't have the design review boards that you have in Santa Monica and Malibu. So that's why we chose building there.
Do you see the key indicators? I mean, this is a long-term investment. 18 months, 12 months, do you see the key indicators where you won't invest like a $2 million or multi-million dollar investment because the property is going to go something down in the market?
Well, what makes me nervous is the projects that may take a year or two to get entitled. I mean, I feel fairly good a year out. 2 years out, I don't feel as good. But I mean, that's part of the consideration of why I'm looking outside of California. Yeah, I definitely feel like we're either in a bubble or we're close to a bubble, especially on the coast. I mean, it's Absolutely.
A lot less volatility, and your exit plan can be to rent it if you have a problem.
So North Carolina, those houses, we could rent those out. You know, if you're building a $3 million house in Manhattan Beach, you can't sell it. Well, I mean, I joke around with my partner, like, well, you move into the first story and we'll move into the second story and we'll ride it out, which is okay. We could do, if we have one house, we could do that. But if we have three houses, you know, we're screwed.
Yeah.
So it's definitely an issue. I mean, I definitely, California has been boom bust for decades. So there's no way I believe it's not going to be boom bust again. So the key is just to get in right here.
Right.
That's where the money is. And then get out. Yes. Like right here?
Yeah.
I mean, along the coast?
Do you have some more room to go up?
You know, it's I don't see a lot more room, but, you know, you don't know. I mean, interest rates really can't be any lower. You know, if they made loans easier, I think we could go up.
There's a lot of landmines out there right now, and I think it's important to pay attention to what's happening. You guys can go to the FIBI Manhattan Beach next week. Tell her on the second Tuesday of next month, you guys will learn a lot about the economy. Going to that.
Yeah, on that same topic, I mean, we are not building in the Palisades now because a lot that we bought 2 or 3 years ago for $1.2 million teardown is now $2 million. And that house, maybe we could have sold it for $3.1 million, is 3.5, so it's gone up 400,000, but the lot cost has gone up 800,000. So I look at the projects and I go, I don't know how these guys are making any money, unless they are paying all cash, and you know they're not paying any, you know, 200,000 or 300,000 in interest. But you know those margins are very skinny for that amount of risk, and quite possibly all those guys will not make any money. So you know there's a sucker born every minute. Definitely true. Go ahead.
Which part of the real estate sector do you have the biggest margins in the real estate houses?
Starting to go up. I mean, you know, I mean, the advantage is like if you're here, it's going to take a while for your project to get approved. So here, you don't mind if the city takes forever. You're going up. You know, it's here that you're like, oh my God, please, I got to get this built and get out. But definitely somewhere, you know, it's kind of like right here, you know, you don't know if you're at the bottom or not, but if things are just starting to pick up. But that's, yeah, anytime you're buying at the bottom, you're definitely. Yeah, I would say I made a lot of money in 2003 and 2004, and I gave a lot back. So, the key is to learn from that. And again, that's part of the reason I'm not nearly as aggressive. You know, being married and having a kid has something to do with that, and being 10 years older. But I'm definitely, you know, you learn from that and go, okay, this, you know, 2004, I was doubling down. I was like, ah, we got a couple more years of this, you know, no problem. So, you know, that ended up being a mistake. But, you know, when I got into real estate in 95, and it had just gone up. And when you're building houses and you're making twice as much money, you think you're an absolute real estate genius, and you're like, with Midas touch, everything I turn to gold. So I mean, there's definitely, yeah, right. So, you know, I did not understand cycles. And, you know, Matt said I spoke at his meeting, and that part of the impetus is like, how did this happen and how did I not get it? Like, we were building the Inland Empire and we thought we were smart. You know, the houses that we were looking at went from 300,000 to 500,000, and we were like, oh, this is a bubble. Let's reduce 25%, you know, we'll calculate a 25% drop. Well, houses dropped 65%. So nobody built that in their pro forma. So
the market can be really, really forgiving on the way up, and you can make a lot of mistakes and still make money. And on that peak and on the way down, you can really get hurt. So it's pretty interesting. Well, thanks, Mike. I appreciate it. Thanks for
coming. Yeah, thank you.